Get your education, boy, she used to say. Because that's the only thing the white man can take away from you. And she was right.
You know, I can't figure you, man.
What's the figure?
I mean, what are you in this for? You want power, you want revenge, you know? What is it?
It's simple, Willie. I just want to be free. How about you?
So do I.
And I hate white folks.
Hate white folks? This is not about hate white folks. It's about loving freedom enough to die or kill for it if necessary. Now you're going to need more than hate to sustain you when this thing begins.
Now if you feel that way, you're no good to us and you're no good to yourself. You ever kill a man, Willie?
No.
I have in Korea.
And when you spill a man's guts in the gutter, you see how fast hate disappears unless you like killing, and I don't think you will. Now some of the cobras will. Stud will.
Why Stud?
Because he's a killer. He doesn't know it yet, but he is. I have another job for you, Willie.
What's that?
We need money. So I have a bank job case. The only thing about it is I can't have the job connected with the cobra.
How are you going to do that?
We use Red Beans, Benny Rooster, Paul Monty, JT, Johnny, and Tom. And you lead the team.
All the yellow niggas, right? Look, man, I am tired of that. I am not passing. I am black. Do you hear me, man? Do you understand? I am black. I'm a nigga, you understand me? I was born black, I live black, and I'm gonna die probably because I'm black. Because some cracker that knows I'm black better than you, nigga, is probably gonna put a bullet in the back of my head.
I love you, Biracial.
We can make a five.
You know, I can't figure you, man.
What's the figure?
I mean, what are you in this for? You want power, you want revenge, you know? What is it?
It's simple, Willie. I just want to be free. How about you?
So do I.
And I hate white folks.
Hate white folks? This is not about hate white folks. It's about loving freedom enough to die or kill for it if necessary. Now you're going to need more than hate to sustain you when this thing begins.
Now if you feel that way, you're no good to us and you're no good to yourself. You ever kill a man, Willie?
No.
I have in Korea.
And when you spill a man's guts in the gutter, you see how fast hate disappears unless you like killing, and I don't think you will. Now some of the cobras will. Stud will.
Why Stud?
Because he's a killer. He doesn't know it yet, but he is. I have another job for you, Willie.
What's that?
We need money. So I have a bank job case. The only thing about it is I can't have the job connected with the cobra.
How are you going to do that?
We use Red Beans, Benny Rooster, Paul Monty, JT, Johnny, and Tom. And you lead the team.
All the yellow niggas, right? Look, man, I am tired of that. I am not passing. I am black. Do you hear me, man? Do you understand? I am black. I'm a nigga, you understand me? I was born black, I live black, and I'm gonna die probably because I'm black.
because some cracker that knows I'm black better than you, nigga, is probably gonna put a bullet in the back of my head.
I love you, biracial.
The Cows, Gus T. Renegade, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of racism. I'm so thankful. Man, I had so many times. So we had disruptions, literally suspected racists come disrupt a live broadcast. And oh my goodness, all the other things that were going on and my own incompetence as a victim of racism. Still learning, trying to do the best I can. But man, where I would not get the audio correct so that people would be missing on the phone line and all that other stuff. Not today. Bang. Today's date. Wednesday, January 25, 2023. So I have been told. Man, that has been coming up so many different ways. Time. And it not being standard. And there being different clocks, like, repeatedly. Anywho. So, today's broadcast, reading is more important than watching television. The intro that we heard, even though from the movie, The Spook Who Sat by the Door, that movie is based on the book written by the late, great Sam Greenlee, the book by the same name, which we read in the book club, that infamous scene. But today's broadcast, wow, I was at the University Library. Again, this was the end of last year. I had many different research projects, and I was there. I was searching. And folks who are familiar, if you go on YouTube or Netflix, you do a search, you watch video content or whatever it is. While you're watching, you look off to the side, and they will give you, you know, algorithms based on what you've searched and or watched. They will show you other content. They do the same thing when you are using a library search catalog, especially a university catalog. They'll give you, you know, other reports, books, that sort of thing that you might also be interested in taking a look at. So I'm doing my search. I wish I had saved like a screenshot so I know exactly what report I was looking at. So I'm looking at the report that I'm deliberately looking for. I glance over to the side and bang, I see white fathers' concerns for their biological black and white biracial sons. I'm stunned because that is not like even close to what I was looking for at all. That's why I said it'd be curious to go back to see now what report was I looking at and how did they link these two. But anyway, so I clicked on it, got the report, put it on my flash drive, didn't even think about it. It's like, you know, I'll check it out at another time. That other time was months later, where I told you that day I stayed in the library. I had like 6 hours, piles of documents and materials and things I was looking for, all these different subject matters. I'd forgotten how much stuff. I had to go back several times, like, oh my gosh, remember that report? Dang, that was important. This was another one. Forgot all about, even had to get to the new calendar. You'd be like, oh my gosh, remember that report? Wow. Absolutely amazing. And even she says in the report there really not a lot of research on this subject matter. I certainly have not seen very much, but I thought it would be fascinating. In fact, people, if you've been listening long enough, Kevin Paulson, white man, he adopted a black son. He was a guest on our program in the middle of 2015, specifically the summer of the summer of 2014. That is significant because that is the summer Eric Garner, Jonathan Crawford III, quite a few of those shootings of black males, but that was the summer. Lots of folks were talking about having to talk. Michael Brown Jr. knew I was forgetting one teenage black male. That was the same summer. He was on our program, white man and an enforcement officer who adopted a black child. And we talked to him about that whole shebang in the archives 2014. Anywho, our guest for today, she wrote that report. There's even a second, an earlier one, White Fathers and Their Black, White, Biracial Sons. Absolutely fascinating. Cannot wait to divvy it up, chat it up about some of her fascinating research. She won the 2020 Virginia Chandler Dykes Scholarship from the College of Professional Education. Got a master's in juvenile forensics psychology from Prairie View A&M University. Pause for Sandra Bland. Super excited to have her as a guest on the program. Joining us live from Tennessee. You know, we have folks out of the Tennessee area, Knoxville, Murfreesboro, Memphis. Super happy to have her on the program. Joining us live, Dr. Lorna Durrant. Dr. Durrant, you with us?
Yes, I am. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for hanging out with us on the program. We normally have older, staunchy, white academic folks who've written their books, books and what have you. So it is great, lovely, brilliant black scholar on the program to talk about some of her super unique, almost like one of one unique research. Before we get started, anything that you would like to tell our listeners about some of the great research that you do down in Tennessee?
Just that I'm very interested in race and racial socialization of children, not just black children or biracial children, but just children in general. I really believe that we need to get to a place where all children, including white children, are racially socialized to what is happening in society so that we can have a better society moving forward.
Hit the wrong button, dang. So for folks who have not picked up with the accent and what have you, you were not exactly born in Tennessee?
No, I was born in the island of Jamaica. So that is where the accent comes from.
Right on. And how long have you been in the States?
So I have been in the state consecutively since 2010. I was here for a year and a half in 2006 to 2008. Then I went back home. I came back in 2010 to start school at Prairie View, and I have been here since. So about 12 years going on 13.
Okay. So she did a little bit of coming in, hanging out, going back, hanging out, going back, and then coming here and being here full time for a little over a decade or so. I guess when, how would I ask? So in 2000, did you spend most of your childhood, like your formative years in Jamaica or?
Oh, yes. All my years were spent there. I came, the first time I came to live here was in 2006. So I did undergraduate studies in Jamaica, so all my formative years were in Jamaica.
Okay, gotcha. Good to know. And just making sure, clear up, make sure none of our listeners are confused. You are classified as a black female, is that correct?
Yes, I am, yes.
Grand. Given your research and certainly what we're going to talk about and what have you, what is your definition of racism? When you use that term, what do you mean when you say racism, Dr. Durrant?
When I use the term, I think of trying to undermine or discriminate or put down someone because of their race. And you have the power to do so. So whether that is in the workforce, whether that is in trying to purchase a home, but just trying to undermine someone because of their race, and you have the power to make that happen.
Okay. I wrote it down. I'm paraphrasing, but you can let me know if I got the crux of your definition. When you say racism, you mean trying to undermine or discriminate against someone because of their race when you have the power to do so. Is that kind of an accurate restatement of your definition?
Yes. Yes, that is a good paraphrase. Yes.
Okay. Is it possible for someone who is not white to practice racism against someone who is white?
So that is kind of up for debate. And for me personally, I think people who are non-white can be prejudiced. But when it comes on to racism, because of the racial structure and hierarchy for centuries, I kind of lean more towards we don't have, in a one-off situation, someone of color may have the opportunity to be prejudiced. But when I think of a more global view of the world and the hierarchy of whiteness for centuries, I hear more on the fact that someone of color can be prejudiced, but not necessarily racist. Well, they can be racist, but in terms of the power structure, maybe one person, but the overall race don't have that power structure to, how should I put this, do much damage that a white person can.
Is that, would that still be true back home in Jamaica?
I think so. I think worldwide there is, even though my country is majority black, the persons who hold the wealth and has some of the power, there is still that white type of white supremacy type of feeling. Even though the persons in political power might look like me, there are still people that can come in from different countries and buy up land and make something of themselves and have privileges because of how they look that others who look like me, even though we were born and raised there, don't have. So I think in many cultures, there is the sense that the closer you are to white, the more privilege you have and the more privileged you are, even if you're living in a country that is not white.
Much obliged for the thorough answer, Dr. Durrant. Global system of white supremacy racism. Indeed. Indeed. Well, let's stick with Jamaica for 1 minute. So, you growing up in Jamaica, I've been to Montego Bay, by the way. You growing up in Jamaica, and you don't get out here until 2006. What was your understanding of racism growing up in Jamaica? Like, did you use that word? What did you, how did you understand that concept then?
Well, I really didn't use that word. I knew it existed. It was more what we would experience more so in Jamaica, and I didn't know the term for it while it was there. But growing up, I didn't know the term for it would be more like colorism or classism. So there would be issues if you're from the upper society. You can have certain jobs. If you are lighter tone, you can have certain jobs. I remember growing up, if you were of a darker skin tone, you it would be highly unlikely for you to have a job like, say, in a bank, being a bank teller, being the face of the bank. So that existed. I knew it existed. I didn't know the term for it until I came to the U.S., understanding that that is colorism. I knew that racism existed. We live in a global world. We would watch American television, American news. So I knew it existed, but I didn't have any first-hand experience with that, if that makes sense.
For sure, for sure. Did you... Wait a minute, I have to back up. So the question I was going to ask I was going to ask if you had contact with white people, but you have to pause on that one. So people didn't get to see the lovely Dr. Durrant. She's intelligent. As soon as she saw, like, oh, they're just doing audio, I don't need my camera on, she turned her camera off. So before she did, I was able to see her. Lovely. So your skin complexion, people didn't get to see. Would you be considered light complexion, dark complexion in Jamaica? Could you get that job at the front of the bank in Jamaica?
I think I might be able to.
Might? Uh-oh.
And,
uh-oh. And it's
different. Like some individuals, like I consider myself brown. I am not the brownest. So I would say I'm medium brown. So I think I may, I wouldn't be their first choice, but I think I may get a pass. But I definitely wouldn't be the first choice. Maybe if I come with like extra charisma, they'll be like, okay, let's, she may be able to work. We may be able to work with her.
Bob Marley rolling over in his grave. Let's see. With bleaching creams, was that an issue? Is that all?
Oh, that is that. Yes, that is that. That is a big thing in Jamaica. Yes, yes, that is, and that is why I'm. That is why I say, even though we are predominantly black, there is still the sense of white supremacy. And the closer you are to white, the more privileged. So people do engage in bleaching their skin to appear lighter. For example, like I said, to get those jobs in the bank, someone would go the extent to bleaching their skin for mobile ability. Like, because the lighter you are, there are certain jobs that you have better access to. So that is a big issue in Jamaica.
Wow. Wow. Did you ever try any of the bleaching creams personally?
No.
Black self-respect. Black self-respect. Wow. Wow. Global system indeed. All right. So before I get fogey and forget, so did you have contact with white people in Jamaica growing up, your formative years in particular?
You would see them here and there, but there was no one that I can say that I had consistent contact with. Like, there wasn't a neighbor or a teacher or someone at my church. So you, when you go out, you might see them. When you go to the tourist area, of course, you might see them. But not someone that I would have contact with, like, on a daily or a weekly basis.
Wow. That sounds... The word beneficial keeps popping into my head. How do you think that impacted your development, how you think about other black people and yourself not really having very much contact with people classified as white growing up?
I've never really thought about it.
All right.
I've never really thought about it. But I guess... I'm trying to think back to see how... it wasn't something that I thought about, like, oh, you don't have, because when I was growing up, it was never my desire to really leave my country. So it wasn't something that I really thought about. And they are white Jamaicans who are not there for, who are not there to visit. They're born and raised Jamaicans. But I never really thought about not having consistent contact with white people. That just wasn't something I thought about. It wasn't, it, I don't know how to say this. It didn't matter to me. Not to sound mean, but it just didn't, really didn't matter.
Context of White Supremacy. I am reading from the Texas Woman's University report, where you got the 2020 Virginia Chandler Dykes Scholarship. Within their report, they write, originally from Jamaica, West Indies, Durrant has overcome obstacles along her journey that include leaving her family to come to a new country, the death of her father, and her mother's loss of her foot due to diabetes. I cannot believe how far I have come, and I feel humbled to be chosen for this prestigious scholarship. Brilliant, as I said, no surprise there. I read that and was just like, wow, that is, wow. My apologies, or just my sympathies for the loss of your father. We've been talking so much about food and how food and racism, how that impacts the health of black people and all of the subsequent diabetes. We talk about that all that. We just talked about that like almost for an hour this past weekend. I just, if we could get more details about your parents, I know it must be a difficult subject, but man, that's, I thought it was important.
Okay. No, my dad, he, and like you're saying, food, he wouldn't take care of his health. He loved to eat and he looked the part. Because he was a big guy. He was like 6'4". He was very heavy. And then he, because he loved to eat, he loved sweet food. So he had diabetes as well. And of course, that impacted his health. And he lost a lot of weight. And eventually, he did die from complications from diabetes. My mom also has diabetes, but she tries to eat right. She's very disciplined. She's more disciplined than I am regarding what she eats. But I think she's had it for so long. And I think that is what resulted in her losing her foot. But she has had it, honestly, since probably I was a teenager, from I can really remember, I've known that she has had diabetes, and she still doesn't need to take insulin. So that is a testament to how disciplined she is with her diet. Because she has had it for over 20 years, and she does not have to take insulin. She does take medication. She does have her diabetes pills, but she don't have to take insulin. So she does watch what she eats, and she tries to stick to the diet that the doctors encourage her to stick to. I don't know if there's anything else you'd like me to add.
Your dad's name, and how old was he when he passed?
Okay, so his name was Derrick Durrant, and he was 56, so he was young. Yeah, he, like I said, he wasn't as disciplined with his diet. He would drink the sweetest drinks, and he would just eat what he wants to eat. He loved to eat ever since he was a child. He loved to eat, and he continued that throughout adulthood. He was in the army, and we always joke with him as children. Like, we always say, we don't know how you pass training. But he did. He got through training to become, to be in the army in Jamaica.
That is amazing, because right now in the States, they are having enormous shortfalls in meeting their numbers for recruitment. Obesity is a huge part of why they can't get enough people, because they have folks who want to enlist, but they're overweight. They said they even have like remedial camps where they try and get their diet. I shouldn't have snickered at that, because that's not funny at all. But they have like remedial camps to try to get their weight down and work with them a diet and all the rest of it. But I mean, that is, man. Wow. Do you think your Derrick Durrant passing away at 56, I agree, that is very young. Do you think his eating habits and him passing away from diabetes, even your mom having diabetes, do you think that's in any way correlated to the system of white supremacy, racism in Jamaica?
Oh. Honestly, in Jamaica, I wouldn't say so. I'm trying to see how it would connect. I wouldn't link the two, because I understand here in the U.S. there's like food deserts where in the black community there is not a lot of grocery stores where you can get fruits and vegetables, a lot of fast food corner stores, but not so much in Jamaica. Like, you can get nutritious food, you can get your fruits and vegetables, you can plant it in your home. A lot of homes, people plant stuff. You can go to the country and get stuff. So it's more so, I would say it's more so lack of proper education regarding nutrition, and maybe lack of discipline for some, when they know better, but they just don't do better. But I would want to have to see some correlation before I can go ahead and say, yes, I think it might have some, and it very well might, but I would need to do some more looking into that before I feel comfortable saying that I see a connection.
Brilliant. Dr. Lorna Durrant, do the research and then give an opinion. I wouldn't be surprised. Where did you grow up in Jamaica?
A Spanish town, St. Catherine.
St. Catherine, okay. Catholic church prevalent there?
Yes, it's not the most prevalent, but they are Catholic church. I actually attended a Catholic high school.
Wow, wow. Did they have any sort of sexual abuse scandal, to your knowledge?
No, no.
Okay. Let's see.
It was an all-girl high school. Maybe if there were boys, I don't know.
It was an all-girl high school, you said?
It was an all-girl high school. Oh, we didn't have any sexual scandals.
Right on, right on. All righty. Derrick Durrant. That will be a new research topic for me. Health. Diabetes in Jamaica, any connection to racism, white supremacy? Because I have not researched that either. Lots to learn. Alrighty. I would be remiss. You've been here long enough that I suspect. Have you heard or even personally experienced any of the conflict about, you know, hey, we've got all these counterfeit black people who were not born in the States, and, you know, they're coming in here and taking up spots at the university and what have you and pretending to be us, and they didn't experience slavery in the U.S., so they cannot relate to our experience specifically under white supremacy of racism. Mm-hmm. Have you heard or even experienced any of that personally since you weren't born here, Dr. Durrant?
I have heard those comments. They were never directed. Like, I know people think that way. No one has ever said it to me personally, like, come to me and say it. I have great friends in the African-American community. But I will say the only incident I can think of that kind of come close to that, I remember once when I was in my PhD program and we had a class on like contemporary issues in family studies. And it was a smaller class, and we were just having a discussion. And one of my peers, African-American, I think somehow the discussion was about how people identify. And I don't think, like, we knew each other by seeing each other, but we weren't very close as I was with others. And she started to make a comment about foreigner, like black foreigners coming to the U.S. And I think our issue was, and they did not want to identify as African-American or think they're better or something along that line. And I just said, okay, I'm very interested in what you have to say because I'm Jamaican. And I said, if I don't identify as African-American, it has nothing to do with thinking I'm better or not wanting to identify as black. I said, I can identify as Afro-Caribbean because I am not an American. I do not have American citizenship. So I don't have the privileges that comes with being an American. I said, if you give me the privileges, I'll gladly identify as African-American. But my thing was more so with the American and not the African, because I know I'm from descendant from Africa and proud of it. So for me, it was more so the American part. I'm like, I am not American. If I'm going to be called an American, I would love the privileges that comes with being a citizen of America. And that is the only incident that I can think of that directly related to me. But I do know there are a lot of individuals who have those types of beliefs and thought systems.
Fascinating. Fascinating. Very logical about it. I am not an American citizen. So, yeah, I don't even have that passport to claim. Logic. Alrighty. Talking with the brilliant, lovely Dr. Lorna Durrant. I reckon now that I segued and hemmed and hawed enough, although everything that we discussed was super important. Derrick Durrant. 56. White fathers' concerns for their biological black and white biracial sons. Man, oh man, what in the world? How did you get interested in this specific subject, white fathers' concerns for their non-white offspring?
There's a lot of reasons. One is I remember reading a Yahoo article that says something along the lines of 10 things that I can do that my black son won't be able to do. And I just thought that was very fascinating. to look at the dynamics between a white man caring for a black or black biracial boy who is going to become a black man. And I just thought that was very interesting. It was also about what was going on and still going on. And you mentioned something about that. But the deaths of a lot of these black men and boys, that really was something that I was concerned with. And I wondered, are white fathers having any concerns regarding their sons? It's one thing when you are removed from a situation, but if that situation is a part of your family, how would you see what is going on? Would you even see that this is an issue going on in society? Would you see that there is a problem going on? Or would you discount it as, no, I really don't see anything going on? So that was another reason why I wanted to do that study. And just in my mind or my belief, and not everyone has to believe this, but I believe that a white man and a black man, as a one of the greatest social divide. So I just wanted to see how a white father would reconcile that, having a black son. And I wanted it to be biological. For one, there are other studies already out there with transracial adopted children, which are white fathers who adopt black children. So that was already being done. And I wanted to do something more unique. And secondly, I also wanted it to be biological, because I don't know. I think there is something different when you are looking in this child's face and you are seeing yourself. And this is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. Does that make a difference when he looks like you with a darker skin tone, when he has your mannerism, when you see yourself in this child? Would that make a difference?
Fascinating. As you said, there's not a whole lot of research. The other research in this sort of area generally deals with white parents who have adopted non-white mm-hmm. children and the impacts and all of that. We talked about that before as well. Dorothy Roberts, her book, Shattered Bonds, phenomenal scholarship. Then you said you specifically wanted to focus here, the biological component. When a white father mm-hmm. looks at that child, this is not someone else's random child that I'm taking in or what have you. This is my DNA, 50% contributed mm-hmm. to this child, even though they are darker than me.
Mm-hmm.
Was there a specific problem that you were attempting to solve with this research?
No, honestly, the research was honestly just exploratory. I was just curious. And like I said, there were no research that I could find. There were many research with white mothers and black biracial children. There are so many research with white mothers. And I was like, okay, what about white fathers? And like I said, with what was going on around the country, and I do know that we do have black women who have died at the hands of police officers. You mentioned Sandra Bland, Breonna Taylor, but it is overwhelmingly black males. So I really just wanted an exploratory study just to see their experiences, how they think, what their concerns are. I didn't go in with any preconceived notion. I didn't go in thinking they're going to have this concern. I was really just curious. Do you have any concerns? And if you do, what are they? I wouldn't have been surprised if they're like, no, we have no concerns at all. because sometimes people can, what's the word I'm looking for? Not delusional, that's sort of a strong word. But sometimes they can be so removed that they don't even realize, like, this is an issue. But sometimes they can be so removed, they don't even see that this is an issue. So I was going in blind, just being open to whatever their experiences were. I was just curious. And though I would have hoped going in like, I'm going to be honest, I'm human. My hope was that I do hope they recognize what is going on in society and have some like concerns or desire to navigate that. but I wasn't going expecting it. I wasn't going trying to find it. I was just going like a blank slate, trying to find out, do you have any concerns? And if you do, what are they?
I dig curiosity. I certainly, and that's how I found your work. That's how we ended up chatting this evening. I'm all about curious. In fact, I think non-white people being curious, black people all over the world being curious about constructive things, that's going to lead us to solving this problem, because racists, they extinguish. They do not want curious slaves. Shut up. No meeting. Shut up. No school. Shut up. Shut up. No questions. Just shut up. Do what I say. Don't ask why. That curiosity is the opposite of the well-trained, obedient slave. Jamaica, South Carolina, doesn't really matter. South Africa, doesn't really matter. I normally ask this, I'm asking this at this spot specifically because this, it seems so critically related to your research here with these white fathers. Dr. Durrant, in the system of racism, global system of racism, who do you think is more informed about what racism, white supremacy is, and how it works? Do you think the individuals classified as white are more informed about how that system works here, Jamaica, South Africa, globally? Or do you think the people who are not white are more informed about what racism is and how it works?
That is a good question. And I'm going to answer it in a way that I hope you get it and your viewers get it. I believe deep down, white individuals do know how it works and know how it works well and know how to keep their hierarchy and don't want, and this is just natural human nature, if you're at the top of the ladder, no one wants to come down from the top of the ladder. I'm just being honest. And if black individuals were at the top, I'm assuming we wouldn't want to move from the top. That's just human nature. So I do think they know, they understand at a deeper level. But I don't think there are some, I'm not going to generalize, some are not actively doing anything to change that. Like I said, you're at the top of the food chain. You want to remain at the top of the food chain. But I do think that non-white people understand it as well, but they understand it in a different way. I hope that makes sense. Like they understand it from their experience and they try to understand it even more to get over it, to deal with it, to navigate it. So they are more likely to research and study and figure it out and try to understand it even better, try to navigate it. But I do believe that some white individuals, they understand it, they may not, what's the word I'm looking for? Act as if they do, but they do. I hope that makes sense and I answered your question. It's in my mind, when I was thinking about it, I'm like, it's going to sound like I'm giving two different answers.
I think I understood. I guess this can be one, maybe I can rephrase, paraphrase, and you can let me know if I'm restating with my own words, if I'm restating.
And maybe you can state the question again to make sure that I got it right too.
Yes, ma'am. We can do both. So the question that I asked, Dr. Durrant, who do you think is more informed about racism, white supremacy globally, what it is and how it works? Do you think the individuals classified as white are more informed about how that system operates, all areas, Jamaica, here, what it takes to keep it going? Or do you think the non-white people are more informed about what racism, white supremacy is, how it works? White people, non-white people, who do you think is more informed? That's the question. Anything you want to add, switch around, or?
No, I think I'll stand by my statement. I think white people understand how it works. And they do things to ensure that they stay where they need to stay. But I don't think it's going to be something that is overtly done or overtly made obvious. But I think they understand how it works and knows what to do to try to remain at the top of the food chain, for lack of a better word. But I also do believe that non-white people understands how it works because they've probably experienced it. They've probably researched it, probably tried to figure out how to navigate society in a way so that they can just try to get on the same level as much as possible as someone else. So I think both non-white and white people understand how the system works. But one set is more invested in letting the system stay as it is. Even if they don't overtly make that known. I hope that makes sense.
Both times, yes, ma'am. Just the word more in there. Do you think white people or non-white people are more informed about what racism is and how it works?
I would say they're more informed and how it works. But they don't give off that they do know more and how it works. It's almost as if I'm trying to choose my words carefully. I think they know more and they know exactly how it works. But they don't want to give off that knowledge that they do know. And it's almost as if they know what they're doing.
That's amazing. That is amazing. Now you have to upgrade from brilliant to the genius, Dr. Lorna Durrant. That is my view on this exactly. And even this is like highlight moment. My goodness, I have been asking that question we will have our 14-year anniversary next month. We have had scholars from all over the world on this program. I have asked that question for years. There have been exactly four people, and I mean, we've had we did over 200 programs last year. We generally average about 200 programs a year. So out of all those hundreds of guests, we've had exactly four people who answered the way that you did. White people are more informed. Two of them white, two of them non-white. And we have been smoking of late because, wow, we have had since October three people. That is crazy.
So within a couple of months, more.
What is going on? Somebody said, Gus, you are getting better at asking that question. Now, that could be. I would even stop if that is the case, because I liked it better when, because we would pile up. We would get people who would interrupt me. They wouldn't even let me finish the question. And they would say, oh, man, non-white people. They're way more informed. Hey, white people, everybody would say that. And they would have the same answer, which stands out to me in a world that they say is supposed to be infinite possibilities. It's not like everybody we talk to is from Tennessee. How is it we talk to people from Australia? Our guest on the program Monday, she was in London. Canada. It's a big world out there. We've had people from everywhere. How is it that everybody not, and it's no doubt, it's no, let me think about it, Gus. That's a tough, it's like, oh yeah, I already know. We've even had people who said, that's a dumb question. Mm-hmm. In fact, that's normally the way that people answer it. Just to kind of put in context the rarity of your response, people normally give the exact opposite answer by the hundreds, literally, and they do it with ease, arrogance. Mm-hmm. Why would you even ask such a stupid question, Gus? I've had people literally say, is that a gotcha question? I don't even know what that is. Is that a gotcha question? Are you trying to trick me, Gus? Of course it's non-white people who are more informed. Why would you ask such a... Now, the basic logic, because even in your response when you said non-white people go out and research and try to understand how to navigate and what have you, I'm going to have to go back to Jamaica or come back to Tennessee and see what non-white people you are hanging around. The vast majority of non-white people I have met, talked to in my life do not invest time studying, researching racism, white supremacy, what it is, how it works. There are some, we're talking, you do that, obviously. I do that. But I bump into way more non-white people, black people, whatever. They are interested in egg rolls, upside down pineapple cake, the football playoffs, LeBron James, Kobe Bryant, Knoxville history, anything you can think of. In fact, we'll get upset. I don't want to talk about all that racism. Mm-hmm. Get me upset, run my blood pressure up. Let's talk about something else. When we go into Monty.
But you see, the problem is when you don't talk about something and you sweep it under the rug, it never gets resolved. And I don't know if it's because I am not from this, because I do have encountered individuals who they're afraid to talk about race because it is a taboo subject. But I don't know if it's because I'm not from here. I have no issue talking about it because I believe it has to be talked about, and not in a way to just cast blame, but just to have a discussion, because something cannot get resolved if there are no discussions. But I find that a lot of people, for whatever reason, like to, when it comes to race, just sweep it under the rug. It is an uncomfortable conversation. It is. I get it. But we have to learn to be uncomfortable or get comfortable with being uncomfortable in order to overcome things. We can't just put blinders on and pretend as if it does not exist.
That is amazing. We've been on for 14 years. Literally, it is in the archives. Me saying that verbatim. We have to get comfortable getting like more than a decade ago, there's recording of me saying that verbatim. We have to get comfortable getting uncomfortable to solve this problem. Racism.
I agree with you 100%.
Talking about it, even thinking about this in some new ways, because, hey, folks, this problem is really, really, really old. Jamaica, Tennessee, whatever. White people mistreating non-white people, that is old as Methuselah, if I can get a biblical metaphor. Like, so obviously, whatever research we have done, it has been insufficient to solve this problem. And like both of us, man, you have a lot. We don't even. And fear. I certainly cannot. Nathan Bedford Forrest, Tennessee, for sure. Lots of non-white people, especially black people, have been killed. Just Bob Marley have been killed just for talking about racism all over the world. Steve Biko, talking about racism sometimes can be enough to have you killed. So, or severely punished, even if you don't get killed. So I certainly grasp, but man, we can be fearful, so-called comfortable, and have this problem go on for another 500 centuries or however long, or we can get comfortable getting uncomfortable, solve this problem, make Bob Marley proud. Let us see. So this study here, all of that, the question, who is more informed about racism? Have you seen, because it's been my experience, man, white people are about solving problems. Like if it's a problem, something comes up, they don't want to take the COVID vaccine or whatever, they get a YouTube channel, a website, a Reddit, a blog, all kind, maybe all of the above. And they go out and get cracking. Did you see like any white fathers with so-called biracial children have like a forum, a Craigslist, something set up to get other white fathers to share ideas and, you know, strategize about how best to help out their biracial children? Did you find any sort of resource like that?
I didn't find any, but majority of the fathers in my study wanted something like that. I would say probably I interviewed 10 fathers, and I think about nine, all of them, when I asked them what would they like to see, they all wanted something practical that they could use to help guide them. And all of them wanted like a space or some other white fathers that they can talk to about these issues, where they will not feel judged, or where they can really just talk about their fears. So they wanted that sense of community. But I have not met any who have decided that they're going to be the one to start that. And I would say to them, you can be the one to start to put together that space that you're talking about. But they all wanted something like that, like a space just to talk with other white fathers, see what they're doing, see what their fears are, just somewhere just to, I don't know, talk about their fears. But I didn't find any who was actively putting together something. And I would say to them after the interview, you know, you can be the one to start something like this. You can be the one to start that support group. But I'm pretty sure there must be some out there in the U.S. or in the world somewhere. So I can't say that there's none. There very well might be out there that I'm not aware of. But of the ones that I spoke to, none of them were doing anything like that, but they all wanted a space where they could come together and just feed off each other, get tips from each other, get stuff off their chests, just a safe space.
Hmm. unless she said feed off each other, it stood out more because she talked about white people being at the top of the food chain. She used that metaphor a few times before in talking about how white people are more informed about racism, white supremacy. Are you familiar with the book, The Delectable Negro by Vincent Woodard?
No, I am not.
That is one of the best books to explain white supremacy, racism, and maybe even Derrick Durrant. Oh my God. The full title is The Delectable Negro, Human Consumption and Homoeroticism in U.S. Slave Culture by Vincent Woodard, 2014. It is amazing. One of the best books to understand white supremacy, racism, what it means to be white culture. It's U.S. slave culture, but unless I'm confused, they had slave plantations in Jamaica too, so I think it would be very applicable.
We did.
Yes, that's sugar cane.
That explains why I am black and Jamaica. It's from the slaves.
Duh. But that book is amazing and explains so much. But that top of the food, delectable Negro, white men feeding delectable Negro, particularly in the context of having so-called biracial offspring. Indeed, wait till you read the book. Oh my God. You write, and for listeners, see why that book is in now top five. Everybody, how would it get mentioned on a program like this? We're talking about anyway. So the report, we're going to the 2021 report, White Fathers' Concerns for Their Biological Black and White Biracial Sons. You write, until this ruling, this is the Loving case. Pause right there. With the Loving case, do you know the details about the main principles, Mildred Richard Loving?
I think I know. I don't know deep detail. I think I know probably what the average person knows, that they were married and they weren't allowed to be married in one state, so they drove to another state and got married. Because in the U.S., it was illegal for white individuals to marry black individuals, and they arrested them, and they couldn't live in that state, so they went to the courts to get that ruling, the segregation between black and white individuals not being able to marry, done away with, I guess, so they could live in the state that they wanted to live as husband and wife without being arrested. So that is my understanding of it. I don't know if there's anything deeper.
A+, I think that's more detail than most people are aware of. It was specific states. Make sure we besmirch the Commonwealth of Virginia, because that's where they were trying to abscond, because it was illegal there. It wasn't illegal throughout the U.S., but it was specific states had those miscegenation laws where it was illegal, and Virginia was one. And then the Supreme Court just struck it down entirely, so it was invalidated everywhere. What I think is important when white people, because they love, love, love to mention that case and celebrate it as, you know, a moment against racism and whoopee, what I think is super important about that case, credit to W. Kamau Bell, guest on our program 2010, he hates my guts, but he pointed out the white man in that case, Richard Loving, he was 17. The black female, Mildred, she was 11 when this romance began.
No, that I did not know.
Me neither. And once I did, that made me think way different about that case, because man, if it had been a 17-year-old black male sniffing around an 11-year-old white female, I know for sure, drunk logic, that would not, even 2023, that would not be a celebrated case, and whoopee, he would have been lynched, castrated, and moving on. We would be talking about, oh, what a shame, and it's this terrible thing what they did to him, and all the rest, or at least thrown in jail. Not, we're going to fight this all the way to the top court in the land. They leave that out every time. People, that's the detail that almost no one, W. Kamau Bell, age difference, right? They're like, come on, come on. Anywho, she continues, after this ruling, interracial marriage were forbidden in many states. In 2015, newlyweds, including one black and one white spouse, accounted for about 1 in 10, 11% interracial married couples, with 3% including a black woman and a white man. Although a small percentage, the incidence of white male and black female unions has increased from 0.7% in 1970 to 3% in 2015. In addition to marriages, there's also been an increase in the non-marital interracial relationships among black females and white males. So much just even right there. I have to pause, process some of that. Even have to, before I can even get that, can I even rewind a little bit? Sorry, listeners, so much detail. When you print to these white men, system of white supremacy. So you go to these white men, man, I sure wish there was some sort of group where I could go talk, a safe space where I could go as a white man, not be all judged and looked down upon, get some help. And you go to them and say, hey, you could start such a group. You went back, unless I misread the study, when you had your groups, you went back to double check with these people to make sure that you accurately processed, interpreted what they had to say, and give them an opportunity to correct, make any changes in case you all made any errors. Is that right?
That's correct, because I didn't want to be speaking for them. So after I analyzed the data, everyone got a chance to read what they said, and not only what they said, but my interpretation and my analysis of what they said with the themes that I put it under. So if I misinterpreted something that they said, they had a chance to say, no, that's not what I meant.
Got it. Okay. Once you followed back up, had any of these folks said, you know what, Dr. Durrant, you gave me the kick in the pants I needed. I went out there and got on Reddit or YouTube. I went to the library. We got a little meeting room. I found another white father, and we're going to start meeting. We're going to meet like once a month, once every other month. Did anybody say, hey, man, you gave me the motivation I needed?
No, but I hope they did without telling me. I really do, but no one said they did.
Particularly processing, since we both agree, white people are more informed about this. If I'm a white man, and you said it's not like we're talking about you got dumb, ignorant high school dropouts, unless I misread, 60% of these folks had at least a bachelor's degree. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Correct.
So these folks are not dumb white people. They are aware. They're informed about racism, white supremacy. I'm a white man. Mm-hmm. I have a non-white child who's going to be a victim of racism in a lot of different ways. They could have been working on this project from the time they hooked up with that black mom, and we hit the bed. We talk about this like, woo, we are going to have a major program together. That's the sort of attitude that they would have from the very beginning, not this laissez-faire and, I sure do wish there was a program. I hope he's not called a nigra. I hope they don't pull a mic. Are you out of your racist mind? That's the sort of thing that I look at like, no. This is just racism. Why do you even want to have a child with a black person knowing that we're in a system you understand better than she does, the black female that you're with? Why do you want to have this child? Why don't you already have? You need a black female to give you a kick in the rear to get with a Reddit. I see white people go out because they don't want to get the Rona vaccine and start a Reddit group. Like, are you serious? Am I being illogical, Dr. Durrant?
No, what you're saying makes sense. I never looked at it that way, but it does make sense. When people want something done and they want to get something done, they find ways to do it.
I see white people. Sorry.
So now I'm really thinking. You have me here thinking, because like you said, especially, and this is something that I find a strength that I actually love within not just white people, but majority of white people. Like, if they're, and this is kind of not exactly, but it's kind of bringing it back to, if you want something done, you can figure it out. Like, their child will be diagnosed with a certain rare disease, and they go to the library and they do research, and they even find out more than doctors and come up with things that can help. And I think that is a great strength that I see within most white people. Are their child was kidnapped and they go to the courts and start a new system where you have Amber Alerts. Like, if you want to get something done, you get it done. That's how they operate. So now I'm thinking, why is it, like you're saying, that you see the need for this, but no one has thought that, maybe I should do something. There might be people out there doing it, so I don't want to misspeak. And if there's anyone out there doing it, kudos to you. But I don't know of any. And certainly no one in my study was doing it.
They are more informed than we are, Dr. Durrant. So I'm of the opinion that they should have thought of all this way before we, like the moment that they, before they even got to the bedroom with this non-white female, like, okay, let's put Michael Brown Jr., Rodney, you got a 64-year-old in your study. So, I mean, hey, you've seen lots of this. Like, there should be no guesswork about all of this. Let's go ahead and get this plan. You could put a nice one together with all the things that you've seen. If you're that, I have to talk about him specifically as we kind of get down the road. But just that's all of that. White, I have seen that consistently, the same thing that you have. White people, when they want to get something done, they get something done. And I mean, hey, what is a greater priority than your child? Are you serious? Like, that sort of, hope he doesn't get shot by the police. Like, are you serious? Come on. Come on. And with all the resources, you can do all this to go help. That's exactly what you said. A kidnapping, anything else. They make whole documentaries about it. In Canada, when they had the person doing the videos killing cats, we sleuth and boom, 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 and document and... You can do all that. You can't make a Reddit group for white dads who have a non-white child. We want to work against racism. Are you serious? You can't whip out your phone and do a FaceTime live video. Are you serious? That right there show commitment. It is not about they're confused. They don't have their blinders on. They're not detached. They enjoy practicing. I like it the way it is. And what you said, too. They are super informed, but they like to give the appearance that they are confused. I don't know what to do. Is somebody could just... You, back to 994, this is from a journal report from the actual study, it'd be page 2, where you were talking about there's a growing number of these white men married to black females. Also, a lot of the research on these so-called interracial relationships, it's white woman, black male. This is also kind of the switcheroo, the white man, black female. It still seems like most white men do not want to marry black females. Even like I said, having... 64-year-old in this. Who is this? Do you know the age that the 64-year-old white, well, he was divorced too. That's important. So
yeah.
Do you know how old his divorcee was?
Oh, no, I did not ask the age of the mothers. I only asked the age of the fathers and the son.
I see. That.
Well, that would have been interested.
The loving case where we got these massive particularly if he's got a 15-year-old son, so that means he would have been about 50-ish, 49, during conception somewhere in there. She would have to be, I mean, I guess it could have been someone in the 40s, but it would not surprise me at all if this is some 50-year-old white dude hooking up with a non-white female in her 30s, maybe even late 20s. It would not shock. Anyway, that sort of thing, that's when I add to, so you didn't think about doing all this in advance. He's not, I mean, he's the only outlier that I saw, at least with that extreme age in, but like, you didn't think about doing all this in advance. You didn't think about a group going to the library and at least putting a flyer up and see, going online, checking, YouTube, like I said, FaceTime Live. You could have just did that on your phone. It just doesn't seem like a lot of white men are interested in marrying a black female. It seems like that is a really low percentage of the white dudes in the U.S., I would say in the world, even to start with, which is a big part of, I think they have whole books talking about that, where in the online dating apps and what have you, like, black females are super low. Like, the white women, everybody is, yes, Becky, Karen, yes. Shaniqua, like, I think that's a part of, you know, all in terms of that's not even what most white men are interested in, hooking up, marrying a black female and producing children. That's not even on the radar for someone classified as a white man. Have you seen did your research reveal that there's been a great change in that sort of thinking? But I think most white men, that's the way that they would be trained. You don't marry a black female. That's why the numbers are so low.
So low. But I think there's a lot of factors and variables with that. One, it is like you say, sometimes it is what the family is going to say and how society may look at it. And that may impact their desire to marry someone, a black female. And then there's also, which this has changed more recently, but there's also the issue of black females in general are less likely to want to date out too. So I think that is a variable as well. I also think one of the issues of them being less open to black females is due to the stereotype that is portrayed of black females. It's the stereotype of being loud, the stereotype of being aggressive. Those stereotypes that is prevalent in films, movie, music, all of that. I think that plays a role in their desire to marry a black female. I do believe if they can look past the stereotype and they find someone that they can connect with and realize, oh, she is not how society makes it seem. This is how all black women are. And if they can get beyond maybe what the family will think, I think they would be okay with marrying outside of their race, or particularly a black female. But that is some will just want to stick with their own, and there is absolutely nothing wrong with that. To each his own. If they want to be with someone of the same race, they are entitled to and should.
One of your fellow black Caribbeans, the late Sidney Poitier, just passed away. one of his seminal works, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, is regularly cited as progress against racism, both because that film came out in the middle of the 1960s, and hey, we got a black male lead actor in a big budget film, and he's got a white girlfriend. That's the way that we normally talk about this so-called interracial marriage. But that is normally presented as quote-unquote progress against racism, white supremacy. Do you think white men marrying black females and or non-white females in general, do you think so-called interracial marriage, do you think that that helps minimize, eliminate the system of racism, white supremacy?
No, I don't think the act of just marrying someone of a different race is going to do anything. There has to be intentional actions. Because if that was the case, we would have seen more improvements by now. People have to intentionally want to do something. And there is a term, and I cannot think of it right now, but essentially it is individuals can still be racist and marry outside because they see the individuals that they're marrying as different from or other than. So just marrying someone of a different race is not going to solve anything if there's not intentional actions behind it. And like I said, you can have someone who is the deepest of racists married to a black person. But in their mind, the person that they're married to, they don't equate them to be the same as everyone else in that person's race. So they see the person they're in a relationship with as other than. So they can still hate the race, but they just see their person as different from everyone else in the race. So with that, just marrying someone is not going to solve anything. There has to be practical steps, intentional things being done to overcome racism, not just marrying outside of your race.
Okie dokie, I'm going to have to remind folks, we are talking to the 2020 Virginia Chandler Dykes Scholarship Award winner. She has a master's in juvenile forensics psychology from Prairie View A&M, Sandra Bland, and a PhD in family studies. Dr. Durrant, very respectfully, I'm going to need you to work your genius brain computer and remember that term. And if you cannot remember that term, you have my email. You're going to have to send me that term and maybe even like a report related to it, because, wow, what are you here for? To forget a term like that? Like, my God, what? No, get it together, man. I've called you a genius, so get it together. You don't have to remember right now. We have you for a few more minutes, so, you know, just get it together, work your brain computer, and give us that, because we need that. Like, I had no idea that there was a word for yes, we need that word, and if there is a report attached to it, yes, we will need that too. Let's see. Man, that is amazing. Let's see. We'll nab a caller really quick. Our victim in New Jersey. I guess other folks, if you have a question for Dr. Lorna Durrant, the number is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Our victim in New Jersey, do you have a question for Dr. Durrant? You should be with us, sir.
Hey, Dr. Durrant. So Dr. Durrant, so I have a sister. My sister, black female, she's married to a white man. So I've kind of went out the way. I don't really talk about racism to her, my younger sister. And I was definitely interested in having a conversation if they do have offspring. She's a traveling nurse. So it was real interesting that because I wasn't really aware of her, how can I say, her knowledge of racism. And on her way from Pennsylvania to California, she mentioned that they were taking a motorhome, so they were traveling, and she brought up the fact that she didn't want to stop in certain towns because she was aware of sundown towns. So that, you know, that just basically, I felt kind of relieved. So I said, okay, she's aware of, you know, racism.
Right.
So how do I have that uncomfortable conversation? I'm meeting with her in 2 weeks. She's traveling from California. We're going to have dinner for her birthday. And this is something I really want to talk to her about, like her offspring and the fact that she's going to have a biracial child. So how would you approach that conversation? That's all I had to ask.
Okay. Well, thank you for calling in. And what I have to say is that you are going to, if you would like, play a big role in those offspring life, especially if she has a black biracial son. So I would just approach it. As you said, she is already aware of the situation that discrimination exists, racism exists. You could tell her that you want to have a discussion because you are concerned about any offspring. But I would like, if you are up to it, not just go to tell her I'm concerned, but to have a potential solution to help her. And one of the recommendations that I have in my study is that the black males who are relatives of these black females can be very helpful in helping to raise these offspring. Because you might have a better idea what her son may experience than her husband or her partner. And if you can phrase it in a way that you're concerned, but you're also willing to, if there's anything that she would like to know, because she's not a black male. So if there's anything that she would like to know, if she do have a black son, you are there to help guide, to help give advice, and to help him navigate society as a man of color. So I would approach it as, I am concerned, but not just concerned, but I am willing to be of service to help in the advent that you would like help. And I think if you approach it that way, no one is going to take offense when you are really, truly trying to look out for the benefits of her offspring. Well, I would hope. Does that help to answer the question?
Oh, yeah, definitely, definitely. Because I just, you know, I wanted to have the conversation, but I didn't want to offend. So, you know, so she sees my interactions. She sees that I'm fully engaged in talking about racism from my social media posts. So I think she's aware of, you know, the older brother that she has. But, you know, I just didn't want to be, you know, intrusive. You know, so I'm going to try, and when we go out for dinner for her birthday and have that conversation.
Well,
I'm going to introduce her to your work.
And you can tell her at the birthday dinner, like, I want to talk to her about something. I'm not sure if this is the right time, because maybe she doesn't want to talk about that on her birthday. Maybe she just want to celebrate her birthday. But this is a conversation that you can have on the phone sometime after her birthday, or if you're going to see her face-to-face again anytime soon, that is not her birthday. You can approach it, but I want you to also be aware that it's her birthday, and this might not be a conversation that she wants to have on her birthday. And that doesn't mean she doesn't want to have the conversation, but maybe that's just not the right time to have it. But you could, you could bring up that, you know, I want to talk to you about something when you have the time, but maybe not on your birthday. And like I said, and you approach the subject not just of concern, but to come with concern, and I am willing to be of any assistance. So you're bringing something to, and that shows that you're really concerned and you want to help in any way that you can.
Definitely. I'll take that advice. I'll save it for another time.
Thank you, victim in New Jersey. Great suggestions from Dr. Durrant, saving it for a great, because those discussions about racism can be explosive. And yeah, some, she might just want to enjoy her day, and then she can come catch her at a time where she's receptive and wants to talk about that very important subject matter. And you can share some of Dr. Durrant's research on this subject, so she'll have some context for all that. Word is in her report. Every time I crack up when I see that, like, oh, see there. Right next to where you discuss context in your report on white fathers and their so-called biracial sons, you write, yes, here we go. Biracial individuals have typically had a place of privilege within the black community. Let's see, Seattle and their amazing airports. Let's see. All right, start that again. Biracial individuals have typically had a place of privilege within the black community. This can be traced back to slavery, when biracial children, because their fathers were white, sometimes received better treatment than slave children for whom both parents were black. Biracial children, for the most part, had skin tones and hair texture that were closer to that of white persons, and some biracial children had more privilege in society, such as being educated. However, despite having some level of privilege, then and now, white fathers may still have concerns for their black biracial children. A couple of concerns evident from this limited body of research were dealing with racial discrimination and the need for a healthy identity. Lots there, but with the first portion, I said, wow, it sounds just like what we talked about with Jamaica, the skin bleaching creams and all. Mm-hmm. But also, I said, just because I making things plain, that is also one of the huge problems with white supremacy, racism, why we are not comfortable being uncomfortable. When we talk about this biracial activity on the plantation, these so-called biracial children are the product of rape. That would be the accurate term, Dr. Durrant, yes?
Yeah. Most of them, not all, but for the most part, yes.
Which would be the ones that would not be rape on the plantation?
There is a power structure. So I'm trying, maybe it's not rape in the, there may have been some individual, and it wouldn't be like a relationship, but there would have been individuals who knowingly engage in relationships with the white men. But even if they knowingly and willingly, there is still this power structure. Makes it, even though it may not be considered rape, because of the power structure, it's like a boss and a subordinate. You have to really think, did they have a choice, even though they willingly do it, but did they really have a choice? Even if it wasn't what the visual or the definition of exactly what rape is. So I don't know what a better term would be, if that makes sense. There are some individuals who I believe agreed, but is that agreement valid because of the power structure? Similar to how an underage child can agree to be with an older person, but if you're under a certain age, it is still statutory rape. So I don't know what it would be like when there's such a great power structure and power difference, if you can truly say that person is agreeing, if that makes sense.
The genius Dr. Lorna Durrant, one with the metaphor that she just, or both of the metaphors that she employed, the workplace power dynamic, and then a child and an adult. Didn't we just talk about the loving case? Matter of fact, when we talk about slavery, we just talked about that. Oh my God, Dr. Jared Ross, we talked about his book, The Uprising or Mutiny on the Rising Sun, which is about a mutiny on a slave ship headed to South America, chocolate in South America. But within all of that, most of the slaves were about 11 years old. That was the average age. And he said, so when we talk about all this rape on the plantation, we are not talking about 20-year-olds and 30-year-olds and all that. A lot of this is Thomas Jefferson, Sally Hemings, when they do all those dramatizations, she was a child. They show you a 25-year-old hooking up with some 35. That's not what this was. We're talking a lot. The loving case. And worse, even J. Strom Thurmond, that's, you know, South Carolina, even more recent. But a lot of this is child rape. Second metaphor that she used. But even beyond that, even if small chunk, you know, I like you, Master Rhodes, and you're pretty cool, and you got a nice cotton plantation and all of that. Consent. She said, the understanding words, terms are so important. My understanding of rape, it has to be no consent. That also would mean you can't coerce consent. You can't do any quaaludes or what have you. It can't be you have a power imbalance where I can coerce, wink, wink. Oh, yeah, she consented to this. If it's a power dynamic where there's no way I could say, nah, get out of here, man.
Right.
What are you doing? Get out of here. Oh, my God. I'd be remiss, man, because of the book that we're reading on Pele, soccer, racism in Brazil. Oh, my God. Yes, they had slavery of black people in Brazil. That is why we have the whole book on Pele and racism. Beyond all of that, they had institutional rape in Brazil. They had institutional rape of male slaves in Brazil. Slavery did not end in Brazil until 1888. This is in Jonathan Sweet's book, Recreating Africa, and that's the exact phrasing he used, and it's very detailed. Institutional male rape of slaves. This was a have to in Brazil, and you see the legacy of that in the book we're reading. When you add that to this conversation, that's why I said that book, The Delectable Negro, Human Consumption, Homoeroticism in U.S. Slave Culture, that it's not just heteronormative, a white man, the slave master with a white or black female. It is a white man with a black boy. It is a white man with a black girl. It is a white man with a black male, not man. It is a white woman with a black girl. Like, when you look at this, like, the big picture of all of this sex, this, all of this is rape, and nobody consents to being a slave. I wouldn't be in this situation if I consented to, all right, white man, white woman, white child, you can dominate and abuse me in perpetuity. No one would consent to that. So once we agree, like, oh, okay, that would be logical, then all of this is rape. Even if I'm making the best to do out of a situation, if this is a more kindly slave boss, whatever that means, all just following the logic, nobody would consent to being a slave in this sort of power imbalance forever in perpetuity, my children and grandchildren and all the rest of it. And then, like I said, this is a lot of child rape. The article that I did not get to take from the library, Crypto Sodomites in Colonial Brazil. Institutional rape of male slaves in Brazil. And that sort of thing is widespread so much they don't even talk about. I'm sure that exists in Jamaica. I'm sure. Don't they have a superpower imbalance in terms of white people? You already told us. You already said that. You didn't even have any white. You already told us. It's no, you said you didn't even have white people around when you were going to school and everything. Those sort of environments, and you got sugar plane and a high number of slaves to work the plantation and a few white. Oh, my God. Oh, my. I am sure the same thing existed in Jamaica. Oh my I will pause. Did you am I talking, am I being illogical, unreasonable, genius, Dr. Lorna Durrant?
No, you're not. No, I'm tracking with you.
Nab one of our callers. Let's see, our caller at 2282 2282. Did you have a question for Dr. Lorna Durrant? You should be with us. Sorry. 2262. Did you have a question for Dr. Durrant? You should be with us.
Yes, sir. Thank you guys for taking my call, and thank you, Dr. Durrant, for taking some time out to speak to us.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Your subjects for the study, the white man, could you give us some of their descriptions? Were they brown hair, blonde hair, blue eyed, brown eyes, something to that effect?
Oh, okay. A couple were bald. I think about three were brunettes. I think there were about two blondes. I wasn't, to be honest, I wasn't really looking at description of their physical. I was more so interested in like their ages, their marital status, education level. And this was about 4 years, 3 years ago. They were typical white men. varied. It wasn't just blonde brunettes. There were, like I said, a couple were bald. They had varied hair color, different eye colors. I don't know if that is helpful.
Oh, no, thank you. Thank you. That is definitely helpful. I'll follow up that question by asking, did any of your subjects have any apprehension about producing offspring that would not look like them?
I did not ask that specific question, so now I'm kind of thinking back to see if that was said or alluded to based on what I asked. The only thing that I can remember is not this person having an issue, but more so is family, in particular is mother having an issue with him having a child with someone who is not white.
Okay.
And I'm wondering even if they did have that fear, like I said, I did not ask that question, but even if they did have that fear, I don't know how open they would be to admit that. Especially because I am a Black female. So as a researcher, I have to think about that too. And how does that impact the study and their level of comfortability? So even if they thought that, I don't know if sitting across from a Black female, if they would feel that is something they needed to divulge, especially when it was not asked. Maybe talking to another white male, if there was a white male doing the interview, maybe they would feel more open discussing that aspect. If that makes sense.
Yes, ma'am, that does. And thank you so much for answering. I think my final question, Gus, will be about, I guess, going to Jamaica. Are you familiar with the Jamaican Code of Arms?
With the indigenous people?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. You said earlier in the interview that they are also quote-unquote white Jamaicans. Would white Jamaicans be included in that one people?
Yeah, the out of many one people or motto?
Yes, ma'am.
Of course. Definitely.
Thank you so much for your response, ma'am. I do appreciate you taking time out. And thank you for taking my call. I'll mute my line.
You are welcome. Hope I was helpful.
For sure, for sure. Did you remember that term, Dr. Durrant?
No.
So disappointed. All righty, we'll check. We'll try again. Or she can email us if it comes to her.
I think I heard it once about 6 years ago.
It's in there. I'm telling you, it's in there. It is.
Yeah, it's there. It's in there somewhere.
Okay.
And I don't even remember if the person knew the term or they just gave the explanation.
Dang.
So I would really need to do some digging to see if there's. But I do think there's a term attached to it. And if there wasn't then, there probably is now.
There should be. I think that is, oof, that's.
And you never know if some of your listeners might be like, I know what she's talking about. They might email you and be like, this is what she's talking about.
UntilJustice@gmail.com. UntilJustice@gmail.com. Thank you kindly. I would appreciate it. And then I would share too, give kudos and everything. I'm always trying to learn. I had that to our caller who just dialed in. I had that on my page. In fact, it was at the top of my page. Did any white fathers report problems with racist family members? Do you remember what the, you said the one white father who his mother had problems. Did he articulate any details, the nature of her problems or concerns?
Yes, I think she just had a problem with interracial couple, and I think he said she got him a book talking about it, I guess with things highlighted, basically talking about how difficult it was. They always, from what I understand, a lot of the times when the family voice their concern, the concern is always for the children, and it's so hard. So even if they just don't want their child to be in an interracial couple because of whatever reason, they tend to phrase it as if it's more out of concern, especially for offspring, and not just, we don't want anyone Black in the family.
Mm, mm, mm. if I pull in current events, I know you being Jamaican and all, oh, God rest the queen, before mm-hmm. her passing, Prince Harry, Meghan Markle, mm-hmm. they did have that chat, like, dang, it seems like they are upset because we're going to have a dark child. They, and oh, that's it right there, white man, non-white female, that is it right there. They are upset that our child is going to be kind of dark, and they are, you know, making all these comments and things, and they don't want to do security. That, with what you just said, and we go back, we're just putting everything together in context. What she said earlier, white people more informed about what racism is, how it works, but they like to lie, give the appearance that they're confused. They don't know what's going on when they're very informed about how they remain at the top of the food chain, using her metaphor. That within this specific context, if I'm a white mother, it sounds way better for me to say, as opposed to, we don't want any nigger grandchildren. Come on, what are you doing? It sounds way better to say, hey, here's a book. It's going to be so tough. The children, they'll be confused and picked on. And I mean, don't you want to make sure that the children can have the bit, like, that sounds way better than, oh, God, mm-hmm. we don't want these little dark children. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree. Not everyone is like that, but I'm sure there are some like that.
Refinement.
And I'm sure there are white individuals who are very open to their offspring dating who they want to date. I am sure there are some who are legitimately trying to dismantle systemic racism. I'm sure they are out there. So I don't want to lump and group everyone and generalize. It might be a small percentage, but I believe that there are a few out there.
They got that poster on the X-Files, I Want to Believe. That's one thing I've seen consistently. We talk to a lot of white people who are in these sort of tragic arrangements, non-white people as well, where everyone has reported that there's always at least one family member, racist family member, who is upset about all of this. At least one, if not many, in that sort of situation. The father, or I guess I'll go in order. So one, this is page 5 of the report. You write, this present study, or the present study, is addressing the gaps by focusing on white fathers and their biological black biracial sons. By addressing the concerns of white fathers identified in the present study, white fathers may become better equipped to raise socially healthy black biracial males in a biased society. So that's curious phrasing, and you have it both ways in there. What do you mean when you say black biracial male or child?
I didn't like the term suggests a black a child who is biracial with black-white heritage. I some people are okay with just using the term black. Some people okay with using the term biracial, but one biracial can be mixed with anything. So I like to use the term black biracial to make it specific as what I am talking about. The racial mix that I'm talking about is black and white. And I also like to use the term biracial because they are biracial. They are not one race. And studies show that when individuals who are biracial are able to identify as such and their biracial identity is validated by others, they have better psychological adjustment. So I wanted to, I guess, uphold that by referring to them as black biracial males. I don't know if that's if I answered your question. I don't know if I got your question correct.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I was trying to grab, and part of this for you, I don't use the term biracial, so that's one where I have to get other people to explain to me what they mean when they use that term, because I do not use that term. I'd have to look at it.
So if someone is biracial, you just classify them as black if they're black biracial?
I don't use the term biracial, so we would have to pick like President Obama. Okay, I would not call him biracial. I'd say he is a non-white person with a white parent.
Okay. I get what you're saying, but that is still validating who he is, so that's okay. But there are some people who just want to invalidate someone 50% of their DNA.
For sure. And I mean, I point out these racial classifications. The people who are to blame for all of the confusion are classified as white, because all of these racial classifications are a bunch of nonsense to begin with. That's why we have all these, I don't even know what to say, goofy terms, biracial and octoroon and quadroon and all that. What can you say other than goofy terms? That I do not use in a regular sense. It would even come back to what is your understanding of race in terms of someone being classified as a member of the black race? What does that mean?
Oh, now you're kind of I don't think being classified as someone as part of the black race, to me, mean you have some heritage that comes from the continent of Africa. But I also, and this is not just my belief, this is also some theory or philosophy of others, that race is also, and I think this is where you were heading, race is also seen as a social construct, meaning who really determines what is white, what is black, and that can actually change. And I like to give the example that there are individuals, and I think Egyptians or people in North Africa are classified as white. Italians are classified as white. But you can have some real light skin black individuals who are not biracial, just having black family, but they are very light. And they're lighter than individuals who are white, but they are black, but they have a lighter skin tone. So how? And I know some people are going to get into, but you can look at a skeleton and tell who was black from who was white. So, but just from phenotype, there are some people who, so it's kind of like, who decides? Because at one point, this country or this set of individuals could have been classified as something else, and somebody just decide, like, okay, we're going to start classifying you as white. And then you become white. So I get why you sometimes say, like, those terms, like, who decides?
Well, it comes down to trying to be logical, you know, that's accurate. That's trying to be accurate. Racists, they lie. They lie about being confused about racism. They lie about being informed about racism. Like, so much of this system is about deception. It's about trying to be accurate with terms. I've concluded that's one of the best defenses against people being deceptive with terms. And my question was, what do you mean? How do you understand the so-called black race? What does that mean? And you said having some sort of African heritage in terms of your genetic makeup. Now, man, the book that I'm looking at right here, I could have quoted Richard Pryor, but I mean, I'll try and be more scientific. Daniel J. Fairbanks, he wrote a biography on Gregor Mendel that I cannot wait to read. But he also wrote Everyone is African, How Science Explodes the Myth of Race. Because I've heard that my whole life, that everybody has genetic material that is connected to the continent of Africa. Now, if that's true, then that would mean everybody is black, which that's what I mean. If we're being logical about this in terms of the system of, and important what you said, somebody comes along and makes a decision. Loving case. This fella is white and you can't marry a non-white person. And then somebody comes and makes a decision to change that. Somebody comes and makes a decision. You are classified as non-white. You are going to be classified as an octoroon or biracial or mulatto. Who makes these terms? Who changes the census? They took Negro off the census. Who does that? Ian Hani Lopez, his book, White by Law, the people who have the power to make these decisions and make them stick invariably are classified as white. Even what she said on a global scale. How is that? You have people in Italy classified who can be kind of dark. We talked about that. But they're white. How is that? There'll be people who are black who are super lighter than some of those Italians. Nope.
That's Negro. Right.
How can that be? Who makes the... The usual suspects. That's what I... That's why I don't... In my view, at least, I think in terms of minimizing the confusion, it's not possible if these racial class, if it really just comes down to the white people who have the most power, they come along and decide you're white, you're Indian, you're Asian, you're black, boom, 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 and make that stick. If that's what this is, okay, let's just say that. And if that's the case, you cannot be white and black. That is not a classification on the census. You cannot be both of those racial classifications. Either you're white or you're not in the system of white supremacy racism. That's why I say with President Obama, it's most accurate. He is a non-white person who does have a white parent. Now we're being accurate. We're being logical for what we are. We start saying he's bot like what? That is not logically possible to be classified as white and black at the same time. That's not even logical based on what these classifications mean. You would have to, that's why I said these classifications produce nonsense because they just lie. They just go, how can you have a book and say that everyone is African and then come and tell me that he's biracial and multiracial and mulatto and octo? Like, come on. And then the number of white people that you have that are so-called passing. And all of this is a bunch of, what did I say before? Goofy. That's the most scientific out of all of them. Goofy, mulatto, octoroon, biracial. The most scientific term out of all of those, goofy. If you can hang logic on these, because it's just what white people say. That's all we're talking about. That's how you get something like honorary white. Do they have that in Jamaica, honorary white?
No, I've never heard that term.
Oh, thank God. That is a really popular one. They had that in South Africa, though. Who made that term? The usual suspects. What does that even mean? While you are hanging out here, you would normally be a non-white person. But since you're hanging out here and you're not too dark and you're only going to be here a limited amount of time, we will allow you to be a pretend white person, a.k.a. honorary white. For business purposes, you can move around, do what other white people do. But this will expire. This is temporary. That's why you are honorary white. That's sort of goofy. That's why I said that's what you end up with in the system of white supremacy. Goofiness with racial classifications that causes a lot of confusion. That's why we haven't solved this problem. Let me see. Make sure I didn't miss. are called. I'm so excited to read that book, though. Both of them, really. Everyone is African and Gregor Mendel's. Make sure I don't want to smear up the entire. Let me. I got to get to the father who is 64 years old. My goodness, that this fella here. He says, okay. Okay, so this is on page 9 out of 17. There's two sets. So she says she's talking to these white fathers with their non-white offspring. And some of them, it's avoidance. Don't deal with racism at all. Try to get their children away from. I don't even know how you would do that. If anyone has tips on how you would avoid racism, I'm all ears. Or challenging it. And they gave some fascinating results to that as well. We get to the 64-year-old white man who is divorced. He does not live with his non-white teenager son. You write, the other father who did not voice any concern, that racism is going to be a problem for his teenage non-white child. And at 64 years old, he would have been old enough to remember a greater racial divide in the United States and raised on a socio-historical time that was not far removed from important historical events such as the civil rights movements and school segregation. Therefore, the socio-historical time in which this father developed might have influenced how he perceived the socio-historical time in which his son is developing. For example, this father stated that things are not like it was 20, 40 years ago, end quote, and that there are power circles that maybe whites have a little more access to, but I don't see that as much as it was. Therefore, the progress that he lived through may have given this father a sense of safety concerning his son. Now again, this, how old is this child's mother? Let me find out that this is a 64-year-old white man who hooked up with some 20-year-old, 25, 30-year-old non-white female, and you don't have any concerns about racism for your child because racism isn't that big a deal anymore. Oh, I couldn't even begin to look at you seriously. Like, are you serious? I'm supposed to be like everything that you've seen. And if you're 64, that means you were a grown adult white man when Rodney King happened. You saw all that. Mm. That means you were a grown adult white man when Katrina happened. You saw all that. Eric Garner, Tamir Rice, you watched President Obama getting a historic level of death threats. You watched all of that, biracial Obama even, right? You watched all of that, and you don't, Dylan Roof, you watched all of that, and you don't have any concern. That right there, again, tells me all I need to know about what it means to be white, and I want to believe. But if that's the evidence that I got, there are some white people who are sincere about replacing white supremacy with justice. Did this fella, participant number 7, did he seem like he was sincerely concerned about the well-being of his teenage non-white child?
He did have concerns, but like I said in the article, I don't know if because he lived in a time, well, but you just gave so many examples of racism now. But I don't know, then it was kind of more, I don't know, in your face and more evident and more at a, it's still at a systemic level now, but people try to pretend like it's not. But there it was, but back then it was very much more obvious. So I don't know that, and people love to use, you used Obama, they love to use that. You use him as the threats, the high level of threats that he got, some of them use it as, but look, we have progressed. We have a black president. So seeing the quote unquote progression of the black race, I'm thinking in his eyes, made him less of a concern than what it was when he was growing up. But like you just elaborated on, but there are still very much issues going on.
Flagrant terrorism. And I mean, with President Obama, I just point to the facts, again, try to be logical. According to the election results, most white people did not vote for Obama either time, 08 or 2012, and they went and bought guns and bragged about it. That was on the news every day. That would be the takeaway. We had Dylann Roof, Peyton Gendron. That is the takeaway. Donald Trump, January 6th. That is the takeaway from President Obama, not some egalitarian and white people are done with racism. Like, they wanted to see him fail. Monkeys and shouting out, you're a liar, and Donald Trump, my God, like, if any white person, that's what you tell me. Like, we just had Emily Flitter on. She wrote the book. She's a New York Times journalist, white woman. Her book, The White Wall. She talked about with economics, there is no progress. Things have gotten worse. Mm-hmm. Education, so-called segregation and school integration, things have gotten worse since the Brown decision. So with just being logical, what evidence exactly are they talking about when they say progress? According to any of the metrics that you would think are impressive,
oh, they're not going that deep. They're just looking at face value. We have a black president.
That you they can hated. Vote. They're lying.
You can sit at the front of a bus.
They're lying. All of that. They're lying. That's not what it is. They're lying because most white people, like I said, they didn't even vote for Obama either time. Mm-hmm. They went and got guns. So the vast majority of white people, they can't even point to Obama. If it was real talk, the average white person, if they were going to mention Obama at all, it would be, I didn't vote for him. I might have went out and got a gun because of him. That's what the average white response would be, just according to logic, based on how they have conducted themselves over the last two terms of his presidency and beyond. And Dylann Roof, just going by the evidence. Peyton Gendron, the birthers, January 6th, I'm just going by the evidence. And for this 60, any white person really, but you're 64 and you've watched all of this and you're with a non-white female, that's not even logical that you wouldn't have, or any other white person, like, to, at least to me, like for other folks, if they have thoughts on that. Let me make sure I didn't miss. Oh, I did miss a caller. Let's see, our caller in the Connecticut area. Let's see, not 5549, last four digits, 5549. Did you have a question for Dr. Lorna Durrant? You should be with us.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah, greetings, everybody.
Greetings.
What I hear what you just was expounding on is just conclusively obvious. That's my comment, basically. Mm-hmm. I could break it down a little bit. But
did,
hey,
you have a question? We don't do comments, sir. Did you have a question? Did you have a question?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Is there any evidence that things have changed significantly to make us think that the system of white supremacy is somehow ending, sis?
No, but like I said, some people choose to look at the surface level, but whether they truly believe that or they're just trying to play a game, but they look at the surface and what they consider progress, because it is not too in your face. it is more implicit and more systemic and not outright. And that is what they use as progress. But like our host is saying, do they really do think that's progress, or they're just trying to make people believe that they think it's progress? Or are some of them just really, just, I don't know. I don't want to use the term delusional. I think that is too strong. But I'm wondering if some of them really do think like, oh, this is great progress. And like I said, there are changes, but I don't think it's great progress. Not for the Black race as a whole. You can have one or two people progressing, but not a great movement for the body. Did I answer your question?
Should I get him, sir? Did she answer your question? Our caller at 5549?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, awesome. Ma'am. That's a direct answer.
Much obliged,
that's
sir.
That's a direct answer. And that's good enough.
Okay.
Thank you kindly, sir. I wanted to get in to, and we can let you enjoy the rest of your Wednesday evening. Since you Jamaican and all, are you familiar with hedonism?
Oh, the hotel? Never been, but I know of it.
Okay. What is your understanding of this place, resort in Jamaica?
I think, if I'm not mistaken, it's a nudist hotel where people like go nude on the beach and stuff.
Hmm. Is this the people that hang out there? Is it disproportionate? Or white people? Do you see white people at heat? Or you said you haven't been. Is it your understanding that?
I haven't been, but most of the people in the resort area at the hotels are white people. And Asian, we have a lot of our greatest tourism, like demographic, is white and like Asian, Japanese, and Chinese.
Black, get back. She said that about the skin bleaching creams before. Like, if you're dark skinned, like, woof, you can't travel. You can't get the best job at the bank. Like, you got to be cleaning in the attic or whatever. Can I travel? Nope. No traveling. Nothing. Just get that mop. Get down in the basement. Do some cleaning. Scrub harder. Dang. Black, get back. Worldwide. Let's see. The other one. The hedonism. When I went to Montego Bay, I remember that. People say, oh, are you for hedonism? It's like, do what? What is that? Like, oh my God, you go to hedonism. Oh, it's great. The white people, the white girls, they would love you. Like, do what? Like, oh my God. Woo. That's what we talked about with Delectable Negro. All of that. Did you co-author the report, College Students' Beliefs About a Campus Support Program for College Students Who Experienced Foster Care? Did you play a hand in that report?
Yes.
We talked, what did I just say? Dorothy Roberts, Shattered Bonds. We talk about racism and the term we use here, throwaway children, who end up in foster care and adoption, that sort of thing, which we already talked about. We talk about that all the time as a result of racism, white supremacy, even non-white children from all over the world who end up in those sort of programs. What was this study about? Did it deal with some of the black students and who were in foster care who end up going to college, and what resources were there for them or not?
Yes. So that study was specific to students at the university where I was, who were formerly in foster care and they're now college students. And what are some of the support systems that were available to them on the college campus, as well as just what are other support systems that they could draw on to help them navigate the world of college and just to be successful in college.
Awesome. Did, I guess, Black students specifically, did they share that, you know, hey, they had resources and what have you that were in place to help people from a foster care background who are going to have some unique needs, that those sort of resources were in place for them?
Yes, but we didn't just specifically look at race. We just looked at students in foster care. Of course, there were some who were Black, and there were systems in place, particularly at my university, where they had a program where they could attend and they would learn about different different resources that are on campus that could be beneficial to them. They had this group that they could come together, so it was a sort of social support because they would meet other students who were also in foster care at their meetings, which really helped them push through. And some of them would say, like, you know, when they felt like they couldn't do it anymore or they may have to stop, it was some of those students who were also in foster care or who were part of the group that would encourage them to know you can do it, you can push through. So they had that sense of camaraderie with each other. And then, like I said, they were in a program where they were informed of the different resources on campus that could be beneficial to them and help them better navigate the world, the college system.
Wow. That is amazing. I'm ignorant, but it doesn't seem like many colleges or universities would have that sort of program in place. Maybe they do.
That's not something that is, it's not like, that's not something where the average university is going to have.
Yeah, wow. That is amazing. I'm so glad they had that for the folks that you spoke with. I wish everybody had that because, yeah, that is, it is. Dorothy Roberts, her book Shattered Bonds, where she talks about the child welfare system, foster care and all of that, and race. Oh, my God. That is disgraceful, important reading. Dorothy Roberts, and she was a guest on the program 2010. We talked about that book specifically. Before we let you depart, global system, now that you've been here long enough and you study this issue, we do too. Just your thought. Mm-hmm. Do you think the non-white people in Jamaica are more informed about racism, white supremacy? Or do you think the non-white people here in the States more informed about racism, white supremacy?
No, I would say the non-white people in the States.
How come?
Because I think it impacts individual in the state on a larger scale than it does in a small country like Jamaica. And even though there are those imbalances of power, like I said, worldwide, no matter where you go, even if the country is 99% Black, there is still that white supremacy that is going to reign supreme that leads people to want to be more white. That is just how it is. But because Jamaica is once all and the majority of the people are Black, I think they don't see it as such a big issue as individuals in the state. And like I said, we would have issues of colorism more so than racism, but colorism is stemming from racism. But I do think people in the state, they're more informed because I think it impacts them more on a larger scale.
Interesting. Let's see, we had a person who dialed in late. Our retired firefighter in Florida. Do you have time to get in one last question, or?
Sure, I can do one last question.
Okie dokes. Let's see. Retired firefighter in Florida, did you have a quick question for Dr. Lorna Durrant?
Oh, thank you for recognizing me, Gus, and hello to the guests. But I hadn't tuned on long enough to really ask a question. Other than I would say that your answers to this past question is a pretty interesting answer. I like how you put it together on your answer.
Okay, which question is that? Which one?
The last one he asked you.
Oh, okay, about here or the States or Jamaica. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Makes a lot of sense.
Okay, yes. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. We have been chatting it up, the lovely, brilliant Dr. Lorna Durrant. Her just one of one. I don't even think there's any other like it. White fathers' concerns for their biological black and white biracial sons. 2021. She has an earlier work as well. 2017. Even slipped in a little bit about the foster care report she co-authored. Fabulous to have you on the broadcast. Learn so much. If you can find that term, that would be great. If not, I certainly understand. But I'm so thankful you could share a little bit of your Wednesday evening with us, Dr. Durrant.
Thank you. And thank you for having me.
Oh, for sure. The pleasure was ours. Keep up your outstanding work. We'll look forward to having you back on the program. Chatted up some about some of your other great research.
Okay.
Take great care.
All right.
Black brother of hell.
Okay. My audio got, I mean, I'm not able to get through a program without some sort of terrorist attack, it seems. It doesn't matter what I am, what's going on. There's always terrorism happening. Yeah, there's always terrorism happening. It is super dangerous being a black male victim of racism. Second time on a Wednesday. Can't do Wednesday programs. I'm going to do my best to not do Wednesday programs because, man, that happened last week where I got terrorized by a white woman. I was in a private study room and got terrorized by a white woman. Like, man, it is unsafe. No black male privilege. It is unsafe, man, everywhere. Anyway, let's see, make sure I didn't mess up my audio. Okay, yes, my audio's there. Man, I'm just trying to get my bearings, and then we'll wrap up. I guess we'll be here tomorrow for the broadcast on our book on Pele, Mario Filho, the black man in Brazilian soccer, our third installment, unless my memory is bad. Do that. Can't believe that. That is amazing. It is super dangerous in the system of racism. Whites, I said that. Be alert. There's so much terrorism, like all the time and for no reason terrorism. Like all the time for no reason terrorism. Especially if you are black. Black, get back. At any rate, Mario Filho tomorrow for the book club. Our broadcast for today, it is still white guests only. Like, I have all kinds of terrorism and difficulty in my existence all the time. Just every day, every moment, especially this year. Like, I am not sure I'll even live through this year because it has just been terrorism every second, every minute, every day, nonstop. That said, our guest for today, non-white female, I learned a lot. Fascinating exchange. It is white guests only. white guests, like people here, if I find a research, like I said, I was not even looking for this report. I was not, you know, I didn't know, but nobody told me about Dr. Durrant. I was researching other things and found this randomly. Like what? Like she said, nobody even does research on white parents, white father, white parents, period. But white parents, and they have white fathers, I guess I could say, since that's her research. But I really haven't seen that even with white mothers. And we did have a white or a non-white female who wrote a whole book about white moms in Britain having sexual intercourse and producing offspring with a non-white person, and how that, you know, all the racism in that, had the racist family members and all of that. I just don't remember. It was 2011. I had to go back to get her name specifically, but we had talked about that before. I guess it is more limited with white fathers. All of that said, man, it's for one to get a non-white person, period, who says that white people are more informed about racism, and she gave a detailed explanation as to why that is. That is super singular. And then I'm trying to think of some of the other important components, and even, you know, going back to recalibrate about the laziness, that was it, where she said these white people said that they wanted some sort of group about, I guess, to help white fathers where they wouldn't be judged. Like, can you imagine a safe space in a system of white supremacy? White men need a safe space to discuss, help get resources for their non-white. Also, like, are you serious? Are you serious? Come on. Come on. Like, all of that is laughable. And again, if this is really a good idea, you could have done this easily, right? Easily. And or now that she's mentioned it, you could have started a Reddit group, Facebook Live, all. Like I said, I've seen white people have way more initiative, what they call it, get up and go, because they didn't want to do the Rona vaccine. I don't want to wear a mask. Got a whole Facebook group, Facebook Live, all that, podcast, you name it. That's the system of racism, white supremacy. I take VGQ. I think she said maybe there's some groups out there. Even if they are out there, none of that would strike me as working against racism, white supremacy, even if they are out there. But, man, what I have heard consistently, like for years, is that white parents, moms and dads, are horrendous at assisting, helping their non-white offspring understand racism, white supremacy, like all the way. Anywho, we'll be here tomorrow for the broadcast. I'm not sure. If folks have a very brief comment, then I will get up and go. Hopefully not be terrorized in the next 30 seconds. Any of the folks who are with us have a quick comment that they needed to share?
Yes, I really liked her answer to that last question. In the way that she explained the logic, you know, with you know, so many non-white people in one small area versus the understanding that non-white black people in this part of the world have more of a frequency of racism that we can experience and or see or hear about, as opposed to the much more smaller area called Jamaica. So I wasn't surprised about, you confirmed it for me, I wasn't surprised about her answering our prophetic question that we normally ask on the program, that she answered in the quote-unquote favor of white people being much more knowledgeable about racism, white supremacy, than non-white people. That's it.
And lying about it, which I thought was important as well, to give the appearance that they are confused. I mean, wow, that is sophisticated, in my view, accurate understanding of what's happening. Any other folks commentary they need to get in before we wrap?
Thank you, sir. I just want to second what retired firefighter said about this area of the world possibly being, I guess, the most informed, and that makes you think of that the answer to solving the problem of racism and white supremacy will have to come from the Northwestern Hemisphere. And that'd be it. Thank you for taking my call. And great broadcast, Gus.
Yeah, Gus. I enjoyed the conversation, even with her suggestion with talking to my, you know, my younger sister. The reason why I brought up the dinner part, because it's not going to be a big dinner party. It's just going to be me, her, and her girlfriend. And again, you know, I've really never had them conversations with my sister. I know that when she went to college, she dated mainly white males. So, you know, I just always felt uncomfortable with bringing it up to her. I didn't want to, you know, be judgmental or, you know, it's her decision. She's grown. She's even said to my mother that, you know, black males weren't interested in her, you know, so that's why she normally dated white men, which I don't believe, because my sister was an introvert, and also my mother kept her sheltered, and she was really into TV, like the white vampire movies, like the, you know, those kind of movies. So it really didn't surprise me that, you know, she started dating white males. So but I'm definitely going to have that conversation. They don't have Offspring right as of yet, so, you know, so I'm definitely going to have a conversation about, you know, how she plans on navigating if they do have biracial children in a system of white supremacy, through the system of white supremacy.
Much obliged. Victim in New Jersey, best of luck with your sister. I really appreciated her response about that, just for lack of a better term, the human element with your sister. I certainly don't celebrate, you know, any holidays. We just had a whole month of that. I think I made my stance on all of that very explicit. No ambiguity here. I don't, all of that. That said, I'm very aware that many people, especially their birthdays, so-called, many people do still celebrate those. And so if they're going to invest time and energy in all of that, racism can be a very volatile discussion where non-white people frequently disagree, and sometimes they can get hostile, even with people who share genetic material. So definitely, if this, you know, person does value so-called birthdays, and, you know, they want to get together and all of that, let them enjoy their time. And then after that, hey, you had a great day. That's awesome. You know, maybe, you know, a couple days or a week from now, you know, we can get together and you can reminisce, show me the pictures, all the good stuff, all the gifts and goodies that you got. You know, if you have a cake or whatever left over, we can have a slice of that, and we can, you know, chat it up about safety of, you know, future offspring potentially. Because I mean, hey, that's everybody should want. If we're going to have children, you know, anything that we should be thinking about in advance, you know, get some sort of account set aside so we can get some nickels for him and all the rest of it. And then, oh yes, racism, white supremacy, yes, especially if I'm swirling. Incidentally, if you think black males are not into you, whew, white dudes are really not into whatever that means, especially if we're talking about marrying. Oh no, white dudes are really against marrying. Roll around in the back seat and all that? Sure. Marriage? Come on. Anywho, we will wrap things up. Man, can't believe that. Terrorized again. Live during the broadcast. Most difficult, dangerous job ever. Just talking about white supremacy racism. We'll be here tomorrow. White people permitting. Who knows? Might be dead. Thanks for those tuning in. Hope it was worthy of your time and energy. Sobriety would be best. It is so dangerous. You have to be alert. You do not want to be all intoxicated where you can't really pay attention. Be mindful about what's happening around you. In addition to being sober, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. We ask that you help us demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. No name calling, no gossiping, minimize contact, or minimize conflict. You might have minimize contact too, but minimize conflict with other non-white people. No, we talk about foster care, no throwaway offspring. For sure, make sure we will remember Derrick Durrant passed away at the age of 56. That is some black male privilege for you. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
No problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.